Good morning and welcome to this, the seventh meeting of session six of the Standards, Procedure and Public Appointments Committee. Can I say good morning to the committee members and indeed witnesses who are joining us later. Agenda item one is to agree whether or not we can take item five in private. This is a consideration and an ongoing discussion about the committee's work programme. Are the committee happy to take agenda item five in private? I think we're in agreement with that. Thank you very much indeed. We now move to agenda item two, which is cross-party groups. The first group that we're going to meet today is a proposed CPG on the creative economy. And I'd like to welcome Claire Baker, who is the convener of the proposed group, to the meeting. Claire, would you like to make a short statement about the intentions of the CPG, please?
Thank you, convener, and good morning to MSPs. The previous CPG on culture was established in 2013, and that's run over two previous sessions. That group was well subscribed and well attended. But over time, we did find the wide range of areas covered by the term culture did create some challenges in terms of how it was able to represent the breadth of groups within the sector, which includes arts, green, heritage and creative industries. I do acknowledge there are some concerns about the existence of a large number of CPGs and the pressure that puts on MSP attendance. But to avoid creating CPGs that were too specific, we are proposing to separate into two distinct groups. One would be based around publicly funded cultures such as libraries, museums, national performing companies, and I understood you took evidence from Sarah Boyack last week. And the one I'm proposing this morning is based around the industrial sector or creative economy, including publishing companies, record companies, entrepreneurs, and so on. So the more commercial end of the sector. This would allow MSPs and those in the sector to have sufficient focus across both areas. There may be some crossover in terms of membership, but the two groups will have a distinct focus that will be reflected in their membership and activities. The creative sector is of huge importance to Scotland's economy, with over 15,000 businesses employing over 70,000 people, in addition to many freelancers. Our creative industries contribute some £5 billion to the economy each year, and there are huge opportunities for increased productivity and growth. And it's a sector which has been seriously impacted by the pandemic, and as we emerge from that, there's a real need to focus on it, in particular in terms of the recovery, both in the short and the long term. And I believe there is value in establishing this CPG to advance these concerns. So I welcome the committee previously agreed the formation of the group on culture and communities, and I hope you're able to support this group this morning.
Thank you very much, Claire. Can I open up to the committee members if anyone has any questions? I'm not getting an indication. As you said, Claire, we met the other CPG in a previous session. It's an interesting to see the idea of such a wide area as culture being subdefined. Do you have any fears about that separation, or are you content that actually this idea of separating between the two or two groups of voices within culture will actually allow people to be heard that perhaps MSPs haven't been able to hear from?
I think that is the intention. We did find when it was the one group, it is such a broad sector, we could subdivide into 20 CPGs. But by recognising the more creative community public sector focused end of culture, and recognising there is also the more commercial, industrial side of culture. And it mirrors the Scottish Government's approach. They have a separate department for creative industries and a separate department for culture. And we feel it would give enough space within the meetings and engagement with MSPs to look at both sides of culture. We do propose, though, to work quite closely together. And rather than have each group having four meetings a year, the initial proposal is to have two meetings a year each. And there is some crossover in membership, but there's some exclusive membership as well. Some people have particular interest in one angle or the other.
That's very helpful. And can I thank you, Claire, for recognising the fact that there are a significant number of CPGs and that the workload commitments that that gives to MSPs. But certainly, I think it is refreshing to see that that has been considered within the, in essence, two applications, but particularly the one that you've presented today. Thank you. The committee will take its decision and the clerks will notify you of that decision in due course. But can I thank you for coming along this morning and wish you all well with the CPG if we are in agreement with it. Thank you, Claire. And can we suspend for a few minutes just to swap witnesses? Good morning again. The next group that we are going to consider is a proposed CPG on India, and I would like to welcome and invite Pam Gosal, who is the co-convener of the proposed group, to make a short statement about the intentions. Good morning.
Thank you, convener, and good morning, convener, and good morning to all the MSPs and staff. The cross-party group on India seeks to promote relationships between Scotland and India. The principal aim for our cross-party group is to work with organisations and authorities to strengthen cultural, educational and economic ties between our two countries. Given the size of Indian economy, forging a closer relationship with India has the potential to be extremely beneficial for our society, economy and development. This is the first cross-party group focused on India in the history of the Scottish Parliament. Indians and people of Indian heritage living in Scotland have contributed greatly to our communities, society and overall culture. Therefore, the cross-party group on India is a great opportunity to promote our common interests and shared heritage, and the perfect opportunity for our MSPs to meet with prominent dignitaries from the Indian community. I do not expect that this CPG will infringe on other groups. I believe this CPG on India will bring great benefits economically and socially with Scotland and India together. And I hope today that the committee agrees on setting up registration for the CPG on India. I also would like to echo earlier on what was said about in relation to workloads. I've taken into account that there are many CPGs and there's many work, obviously a lot of workload, but also the fact that how important this is to building our economy after the pandemic, and I have cross-party support on this group. So thank you.
Thank you very much, Pam. Do any members have any questions? No? I was going to say, Pam, you do have a strong list of cross-party membership of the group. But I was just going to ask about the non-MSP members of the group. I see you have support of the Consulate of India and PG Paper Company Limited. Who are they going to provide the secretariat support, is it?
Yes, convener, PG Paper will provide that. And the Consulate of India will also provide us guidance, connections and links and relationship building on three of the areas, education, culture and trade.
So hopefully allowing you to build on the very right intention of allowing access, experience and education to MSPs of a very important country, indeed subcontinent, going forward.
Absolutely. And it's something, convener, that's been brought up in my portfolio, working with universities and colleges. They're talking about how we actually make Scotland more attractive to the world, and we bring in more students from all over the world. But these students, as you know, they're not just students, but we bring in exchange of knowledge and technology, which is, I think it's fantastic for Scotland that we will have these relationships building.
Excellent. Thank you very much for coming this morning. As you heard with the last one, the committee clerks will be in touch once the committee's taken its decision, but I hope that will be a positive one. And can I thank you again for attending this morning?
Thank you very much, convener. Thank you, MSPs.
We don't need an agenda, do we? Because we just do it. The next group that we're going to consider is a proposed CPG on wellbeing economy. And I would like to welcome Paul McLennan, who is a member of this committee, who is going to be the convener of the proposed group. Paul, would you like to give the committee an explanation about the CPG that is being proposed?
Yeah, good morning and thank you, convener. And just to refer members to my register of interest, I'm a serving councillor in East Lothian Council. The stated purpose of the group is to increase understanding and delivery of a wellbeing economy, one which is a service on people and planet, and to promote delivery of sustainable, fair and equal economic development across a range of interest areas, public, private and third sector, as well as local and national government. I think the thing with the wellbeing economy has an overview of various areas, including health, equalities, economy and sustainability areas. I think we recognise there is some crossover in CPGs and regarding we're looking at, so it's renewable energy, carers, and I know there was a proposed at the time when we put this in about the CPG and circular economy, which has obviously been approved now in health inequalities. So I think we can work in conjunction with them, and it's not in competing with them. I think, I suppose, the wider aspect is, since being elected around about 6 months ago, we've heard many members from all parties talking about they want to move towards a wellbeing economy. And I think one of the purposes of the group is to try and increase understanding and delivery of what a wellbeing economy looks like. We have a wide range of participants in the group. The Wellbeing Alliance in Scotland are our secretariat, but we have a membership from Scottish Enterprise, UN House in Scotland, also the SDUC, and since we submitted the form, we've had Queen Margaret University and Public Health Scotland also join the group. So, as I said, willing to answer any questions, convener, but yeah, looking forward to working with the group.
Excellent. Thank you, Paul. Do any of the other committee members have any questions? No? I was just going to pick up something that you said there, Paul, about really what the definition of a wellbeing economy is. And it's certainly a phrase that gets bandied around a lot. But when you start to dig beneath that, I think people's understanding is very different and broad. And certainly looking at the wide number of organisations, non-MSP organisations that are going to be involved, it certainly would seem a beneficial way to try and reach a consensus on what we mean, but then more importantly, move forward to reaching that. So thank you. For the purposes of clarification, when we come to make a decision on the cross-party groups, Paul will step out of the committee and will not be part of that decision. But can I thank you for coming along this morning, Paul? And could we have a short suspension, please? Thank you. And the final group that we will consider today is the proposed CPG on social work. And I would like to welcome Fulton McGregor, who is joining us remotely today, who is the proposed convener of this new group. Fulton, would you like to give a short explanation about the intentions of the group, please? Mute.
But declaring an interest as a registered social worker with the Scottish Social Services Council. Prior to being elected in 2016, I worked as a social worker for around 12 years, firstly in childcare and protection and more latterly in community criminal justice social work. And I'd also just like to say at the start of this convener, if you don't mind, I'd like to thank Emily Galloway from SASWA and Rob Byrne from my office for all their work thus far in bringing this group together. The main aim of the proposed cross-party group in social work is to promote an understanding of the complexities of social work profession, bring together its voice and positively raise its profile. I believe that the establishment of this group is justified, as the social work profession is a single profession, very connected to but separate from, say, social care and other health services. Social workers hold specific duties for welfare and have statutory powers to intervene where necessary across a range of areas. The governance and delivery of social work, as members will be aware, is spread across local authorities, the independent and third sector, and health and social care partnerships. And because of this, it can often be challenging to bring these diverse experiences and voices together to support and influence national policy and legislation. And that's also seen by the fact that the social work is covered across a variety of government portfolios as well. In addition, there can be a lack of, or a stereotypical, even public understanding of the profession, often negatively perpetrated by the media. And I ask colleagues to possibly think of the social worker in soap operas who comes into people's houses and threatens to remove their children. This obviously, in my experience, and I'm sure others will know as well, couldn't be further from reality, but nonetheless, it is a perception that the public sometimes can have. I propose that this cross-party group will provide a space to collaboratively address issues and work towards solutions in the profession for people who use social work services, their families, for communities, and of course for social workers themselves. It will also seek to raise awareness of the profession and to raise its profile in a positive way, to better enable the public to understand the key role that social workers play in people's lives. And this becomes even more significant as Scotland moves towards establishing a national care service, of which social work will likely play an integral part. Social work is a very interconnected profession, and there are some overlaps with existing cross-party groups. We've had a wee look at that. However, like the committee structure in Parliament, there is no one group already existing that can provide the forum sought by the creation of this particular group. If approved today, some issues that the cross-party group will consider include the public perceptions of social work, the National Care Service, poverty, drug deaths, self-directed support, and this is just to name a few. The group will be open to members across the chamber. I've already secured cross-party support, and I hope to have inspiring speakers and will invite relevant government ministers regularly. And as I've said before, it will be a variety of government ministers will be able to come along to the cross-party group, given the portfolios covered. Finally, I want to thank, by ending, the Scottish Association of Social Work, SASWA, who have been a driving force in getting to this stage, and at our initial meeting have agreed to become the secretariat if the group is approved. And I can assure the committee and the Parliament that in SASWA they will have a very thorough and proactive secretariat for this cross-party group. Thank you, Convener.
Thank you, Fulton, and thank you for that very full and positive description. I understand, Bob, you have a question?
Yes, thank you, Convener. Good morning, Shelton McGregor. Thank you for the opening statement this morning. You partially answered my question towards the end of your opening statement, because they dropped the request to speak in the chat box before you'd completed your presentation. But I was looking, Fulton, at the range of organisations that you have signed up for the proposed cross-party group, and they're pretty varied, and it made me think about there are lots of different voices within the social work system, and it's quite difficult perhaps for social work to speak with one voice, or when they're trying to raise that voice in terms of policy development within Scotland, some voices may get inadvertently squeezed out. So I'm just wondering your thoughts in relation to, you mentioned the drug death crisis, you mentioned the National Care Service, active ongoing policy areas. Do you think the cross-party would offer something to ensuring that the social work community have a strong voice at the heart of those policy developments? And in terms of self-directed support, I sat on the committee that brought self-directed support in Scotland. There's probably need for some post-legislative scrutiny in relation to that, for how it's actually operating in practice. Now, I get that you're not a subject committee of the Parliament, but do you think there's a role for your cross-party group in teasing out some of the strengths and perhaps areas that need improved in relation to self-directed support? Sorry for the length of the question. I hope you see it as a positive question, because I'm generally interested in the role the cross-party group could play, and I want to give you the chance to put some of that on the record this morning.
Thank you, Bob. Fulton?
Yeah, thanks, Bob. I appreciate the question, Bob, and I know that you've been a supporter of social work and related services throughout your time as an MSP, and we've spoke regularly about that. And I know the work that you do links very much in social work. I think towards the end of the last term, SASWA actually held some hustings that I attended in behalf of my party, and there was all the political parties were represented at. And one of the asks that they made through those hustings was that, because of the way the discussion was going, was that should the people who were there be re-elected, would they commit to the establishment of a cross-party group, which I committed to, as did others. But the ask for that cross-party group came out after a very full and lengthy discussion about where social work actually sat within the Parliament, because as you've said, because you even talked about the self-directed support there, the drug crisis that we've got, these are different social workers that would be involved in those areas. But social workers often have, as I said in the opening statement, often have the statutory powers over various areas, whether that be children, families, adult justice, or adult social care. And it has been really difficult to bring voices together. They've never really had a major voice through the committee structure, for example. Yes, you know, social work organisations are invited to committees. I'm on two committees that they do that regularly. But because of, say, for example, the justice social workers would come under the justice committee, which I sit on, the children and family social workers would be more looking at the education committee, and the ones in health and social care would be more looking at the health committee. So that it has been difficult to bring together a forum that maybe represents social workers, the issues and dilemmas that they're facing, particularly through the pandemic and as we build back. And I think this cross-party group does offer that opportunity. The two issues that you mentioned, Bob, will be very, very much at the forefront. I think they're already, I think SASWA are already looking at, probably watching this committee meeting actually and hoping that it will be approved, and already thinking about how those two can become future agenda items. So absolutely. And all members, whether they're current members of the group or not, would be welcome to come along to any meeting. Thanks, Bob.
Thank you, Fulton. And I know that Tess White has a question for you. Tess.
Hello, thank you. So I noticed the CPG has a broad and an important remit. And I also note you've got a very large selection of organisations that are going to contribute. And they're varied from Unison through to Children in Scotland and SAMH. So hopefully that bodes well. Just my question, if I may, is because it is very broad, what are your own personal success factors? How will you know when you've got a good CPG in your own mind?
Fulton, a very open question for you. What would be success with this CPG?
Thanks, convener. Sorry, I was jumping in there to answer. Convener, apologies for that. I think it's a big question. It's a good question from Tess. I think I suppose in the last term I had the privilege of starting a cross-party group from scratch and going through this process. And I believe that cross-party group has been successful. The organisations that have attended it regularly, and we've pulled together some work which we hope will help other MSPs see what's going on in that sector. And that's what I would hope for this as well. You know, the discussions that I've had since that Hustings that I discussed with that I mentioned with SASWA have been really, really thorough. I've got a lot of faith in them. They are very committed to the group. I come from it. If the group is proposed, I would be the convener, following on from the initial meeting. And I've got a background in social work myself, as I said. I'm very passionate about it. Even, you know, during the term I've been an MSP, I've maintained my registration as a social worker. So I'm very passionate to hear what's going on. I've got connections myself to the profession, you know, outside of being an MSP. So I have a lot of faith that it will be a successful cross-party group. But I think in terms of the question, Tess, I think the big thing for me would be if we are producing information, material, as a result of the cross-party group that is influencing policy and other MSPs in the Parliament chamber, that for me would be a big success.
Good answer, thank you.
Thank you, Tess. Thank you, Fulton. And I just wanted to firstly note the thanks that you extended at the start to the others who've helped in this. Sometimes there are nameless people who are working very hard behind the scenes in CPGs, and we may need to find a way of recognising. But also just to highlight the two points that you brought up in your speech and also were contained in the purposes of the group, which is to allow a space to collaboratively address issues which cross so many fields. And if I can also echo your phrase, it will also seek to raise awareness of the profession and to raise its profile in a positive way, which I think is much needed. Thank you for coming today. We will take a decision later and the clerks will notify you in due course. But can I thank you for your application and submission today, Fulton? Thank you.
Thank you, Kintia.
Committee, we're now going to move to agenda item 3, which is the cross-party group approval. And absolutely, as explained previously, Paul, who is a member of this committee and gave evidence to us this morning, is going to step outside of the committee and not take part in this decision. Agenda item 3 is for the committee to consider whether to accord recognition to the proposed cross-party groups on creative economy, India, wellbeing economy, and the final one we heard from on social work. Can I invite any comments from any of the committee members before I put a decision? Edward, would you like to make a point?
Yes, Convener, thank you very much. I'd just like to put on record that, I mean, it is really difficult for us as a committee to look at each of the committees individually and not think there is huge merit in all of them and all that they're trying to achieve. I'd just like to place on record that I have concerns on the number of committees within the Parliament and the amount of time that MSPs stand to have to commit to fulfil their duties on committees. And I know Paul, a member of our committee, is on numerous committees for which I applaud him for. But I do think there comes a stage where, as a committee, we need to consider what is reasonable and right. And, Convener, I'm delighted it's not for me. Committees aren't right because it's an impossible task. But I just have concerns about the amount of time that is being committed by MSPs.
Thank you for that comment, Edward. And I know we have had discussions in other meetings regarding concerns over the quantity, if not the quality of CPGs, but also more importantly, as you say, the time commitment that is required. And for CPGs to work as successfully as I think Tessa's question managed to draw out with regard to the last one, MSPs have to be able to put the time into it. But that time commitment can very, very quickly run away. And I know as a committee we will be returning to this sooner probably rather than later, not with regard to individual CPGs, as you rightly mentioned, but as to the landscape in which the CPGs sit. Does anyone else have any comments? Then can I ask, are members agreed to accord recognition to the proposed cross-party groups on the creative economy, India, wellbeing economy and social work? I'll take that as an affirmative, and I'm just going to invite Paul to come back into the committee meeting. After the re-register, yes. Thank you, Paul. We now move to agenda item 4, which is cross-party groups who are seeking to re-register. Our item today is for the committee to consider a change of purpose for the proposed CPG on deafness, the proposed CPG on international development, and the proposed CPG on Tibet. We are also going to consider a change of name and purpose for the proposed CPG on challenging racial and religious prejudice. As members are aware, any change of name or purpose by a group is required to be approved by this committee. Do any of the committee members have any comments on any item herein? No? Thank you. Do members agree that the proposed CPGs on deafness, international development, Tibet, and challenging racial and religious prejudice can be re-registered in the new session? And I find the committee in agreement with that. We are now moving to an item in private, so this will end the public part of the meeting. Thank you.